I'd like to now introduce our next amazing speaker, Deb Liu. She is the CEO of Ancestry. Like many of us here today, Deb is an introvert, surprising but true. But she's learned how to speak up in an authentic way and have a deeper, more meaningful connection with people. Do you want to know how it's done? Me too. So please help me welcome Deb Liu as she shares her story and provides tips on how to develop your voice and overcome fears around becoming more vocal. Remember, I know you're going to have a lot of questions for Deb, so please make use of the live Q&A, and we are going to leave plenty of time to answer as many questions as we can. Once again, in the live Q&A, get your questions to Deb. Deb, take it away.
Thank you so much, Kim. I get asked a lot about brand building. You know, what should someone do to build their brand? How do I get more followers? How can I get people to recognize me for what I do? And, you know, my advice is actually don't build your brand. In fact, find your voice. And I'll share a little bit more about that. So I'm going to show you some stuff, and I'm going to show you an image, and I want you to tell me the one word feeling when you see something. So go to the next slide. And, you know, every time you see something, you actually have a feeling. And so go to the next slide and we'll do this exercise together. So what do you feel when you see this? Windows, platform, PC? What about the next one? And Apple stands for design or innovation. Again, the difference between those two logos gave you completely different feelings. What about the next one? For me, this brings back memories of drinking an ice cold Coke in a hot muggy day in the South. And so the word that comes to my mind is refreshing. But this actually brings different memories for me because in the South, as I mentioned, I'm from, everything is called a Coke, even a Pepsi. Next is actually a logo that all of us recognize. Remember Yahoo Mail, auctions, dating? I was an early adopter, but looking at it, this logo no longer means search. But the next slide does. Google's synonymous with search. How did that change? And the next one? When you see this, what do you think? Fast, consistent? Or the next one is actually something a little bit different, maybe fresh or delicious. Why do you get these different feelings? And the next slide, you can go to the next slide. Brands are about attributes, what they evoke in you. And each of those brands created a feeling in you, a moment, a memory, a taste. Whether it's innovation, trust, old school, brands mean something. You know, every single time I go by a McDonald's and I smell fresh French fries, it reminds me of when I was in preschool. I was 4 years old, I lived in New York City, and you know, my family wasn't that well off, but on a rare occasion, my mom would bring me to get some French fries. And it was a super special treat, and every time, now many, many years later, every time I go by a McDonald's, I still remember that feeling. Brands are shortcuts, but they're often one note. And their purpose is to encapsulate a whole experience in a word or a feeling. Next slide. What's your feeling when you see this? It's probably like the next slide here, which is photos of parades, of fireworks, the thrill of rides, the feeling of childhood, fun, adventure. This is what we hope Disney feels like. But on the next slide, it's actually what it really feels like, especially with my family. Long lines, hot cranky kids, and crowds to no end. Think about the last time you went to Disney and you stood an hour to ride one ride that lasted maybe 5 minutes. A marketing expert once came to a class I took and they shared that Disney goes out of their way to show fireworks, parades, kids having fun so that you will remember and evokes those good times on your last trip there. They actually have a team called Imagineers that are engineers so that you can only remember and feel the good things. But the reality is often much different. And part of the brand is to remind you of the good. And so you forget the hot, muggy days and remember the happiest place on earth. Next slide. But people aren't brands. It's tempted to think that you have to have some personal brand, some word, that you have to have this, put your best foot forward. But we actually are not brands at all. We're multifaceted. And so instead of building a brand, having people say, oh, she is this, instead, find your voice. Next slide. This is an image of me in front of F8. So F8 is a conference that Facebook held every year, and I was the head of Facebook platform. And I stood in front of 5,000 people and announced new products. every year for many years. It's a projection of power and strength, and it was about 10 minutes of my life every year. The next slide is something that's much more common in my life, which is the reality, which is my children, my family, in our picture corner. I call this our picture corner, but it's actually the area in front of our pantry, you can see the doorknob, because it's literally the only uncluttered place in our house where I could take photos. But that's what human beings are. We are many things to many people, whether it's 5-10 minutes on a stage in front of thousands of people, or who you are every day with your family. Next slide. But one reason people can't be reduced to a few words is because people are so many things. I was an engineering student, an MBA candidate, a consultant, a co-founder of a nonprofit, the CEO of Ancestry. I'm a wife, mother, sister, and friend. And I learned to find my voice the hard way. Next slide. I was born in New York City, the child of immigrants. And my dad actually at work didn't get the engineering role he had wanted. He actually had an engineering degree, but because of discrimination, he was actually moved to a different job and was unable to move forward. So he decided suddenly to get a job with the US government, an entity that he was told doesn't discriminate. So when I was 6 years old, we packed up everything we had and we went to South Carolina. So imagine growing up in New York City, the hustle and bustle, and going to a state with fewer than 1% Asians that you had never been. I grew up in a place where I was told to go back to where you came from constantly. And by the way, they didn't mean New York. And I remember learning to stay quiet. If only people didn't comment on me, if no one noticed me, if I could just hide, then no one would comment. No one would tell us to go back to where we came from. People would stop making fun of me and stop making my life difficult. I went on to Duke to study engineering, and I loved it because being quiet and introverted served me well. There was little demand of speaking up, and I liked building and learning without having to speak. But you know, the things that make you successful in life will one day stop working for you. And that happened when I went to Boston Consulting Group. I knew I was a pretty good analyst and a pretty good slide writer, but I really struggled there. And the feedback I heard is you need to learn to speak up. You need to learn to have a voice. You need to influence. And I kept thinking, you know, my voice speaks for itself. What are you talking about? And my work is what I am. Why do I need to say anything? I went on to go to Stanford for business school, and I took a class called organizational behavior. And that's when I learned that what I had learned thus far was all wrong. Because what you do is important, but who you are and how much you connect with other people, that's actually what people remember you for. And that's when I learned to speak up and live much more authentically. And I learned to be much more vulnerable. If you go to the next slide. So this is actually who I am, because every time I step in a room, I'm given a chance to leave an impression, good and bad. My words, my body language, everything I say. To someone, you know, you could be a list of facts, the CEO of a company, the founder of Women in Product, a mom of three, a writer, a coach, a mentor, on the board of Intuit. But a voice is not what you think. It's actually what you believe, what influence you have, how you make other people feel. It's about your vulnerability, your openness. It's not about perfection or resumes. This isn't LinkedIn and a list of things that you've accomplished, but rather your truth and your authenticity. And so I ask you in the next slide, what is the one word feeling for you? Next slide. Because there is not one word. It is about who you are. I was told in business school that I was closed off, that I had to open up, that people didn't trust me, that, you know, they really felt alienated from me. And that was really hard to hear. And yet, you know, as I went forward, I realized what that really meant. Next slide. Because I was projecting something. I wasn't real. I wasn't connected with anybody. I was an image, a facade. And so I had to learn to speak and speak who I was. Next slide. So I always remind people, don't think about the words you say. Think about the feeling you want them to leave with. We focus too much on the words and not on the other person who's receiving it. Next slide. Every day, every moment in a meeting, you're actually telling a story, whether you like it or not. If you're happy or joyful, if you're excited, if you're anxious or upset. I remember over the last 8 years, I've had an open door policy and mentored over 1,000 women. And one of the women who came to me was struggling to gain traction in her career. And just meeting her, I had never met her before. I said, can I take a video of you and let's just role play me being your manager and you being you? And then at the end, I showed her the video. She didn't make eye contact. Her voice was so low, she couldn't even hear her own video. And she said, "I think I understand what you're saying now." Her goal was to stay in her comfort zone, but she didn't understand the other person wasn't receiving her at all. She was speaking volumes through her actions and not through her words. Next slide. So the question is, what is the story that you're leaving behind in every conversation, in every meeting, in every interaction? If you don't say anything, were you even there? I'll give you an example. I can tell you two things about Ancestry, the company that I'm CEO of. I can tell you we're a company that builds family trees, and we are. Or I can tell you we're a place where everyone can discover, craft, and connect over their family story, that we build family legacies. Which do you think is more impactful? Which words attracts you to our company and wants to make you try out the product? Words really matter, but also the feeling evokes really matters too. And both things can be true about our company, and yet only one of them is actually connecting with you. Next slide. So I leave you with this, which is, what story are you telling about yourself? What story do you tell yourself every day? What are you projecting? You know, because in the next slide, because whatever you're feeling inside, next slide, that's the story you're actually telling about yourself. That is actually what you're becoming. And so if you focus on connection, if you focus on opening up, it will give you that opportunity to connect and to really be authentic. Connection isn't commonality. It's authentically finding common grounds. It's not about just one person. It's about two. And so tell your story. Learn to connect. Be vulnerable. Be open. Finding your voice means speaking up, standing out, and leaving every conversation and every moment better than having come to it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deb. It's really interesting. We were talking just before your presentation about this is your first role as a CEO. And I'm sure everyone would wonder, how did you find your voice to become a CEO when you hadn't had that experience before? And I really want you to address this, because I want to inspire many of those watching right now to not let not having been the voice of a CEO before prevent them from becoming the voice of a CEO now and into the future.
That's a great question. Actually, I remember I was invited to interview for the CEO position for a public company. This is before Ancestry. And when I saw the email, I laughed and I kind of closed it, and I came back to it and they asked me again. And this executive recruiter took me out to dinner. He's one of the most famous executive recruiters in the Valley. His name is Jim Citrin. He's actually written books about hiring CEOs and how CEOs can succeed. And I remember at dinner, he said to me, I said, "Why me? Like, I can't do this." And he said, "Why not you?" And he said, "You know, every CEO has to be the first time, like someone has to be CEO for the first time." Yeah. And it had never occurred to me. When he said that, I said, "You know, you're right." And I could never have imagined myself actually even interviewing, much less taking the role. And that experience taught me so much, because he had said to me something and it opened up something inside of me, which is that sometimes we think that we have to be the expert, we have to be the smartest person in the room. Mm-hmm. But someone has to take that first step. And somebody interviews for that job and gets it for the first time. And he said, "Why not you?" And someone else believing in me that much reminded me just how precious that is, and that he gave me the courage to actually go out there and interview again and again, and, you know, eventually finding this role.
Wendy was just mentioning that it's something she struggles with every single day, and I've seen it repeated just a few times. Sade also saying, you know, "Why not you? Why not you? Why not me?" How do you, and this is a loaded question because I think it's different for everyone, but any advice that you might have to get over the "why not me" or "why me," you know, kind of thing? Like, how do you get past it? How do you actually go, "Okay, why not me?" And then look for all those excuses as to really why not me?
You know, I wrote this article about imposter syndrome because I suffer from it terribly, as you can tell from that conversation with Jim. But it was because, you know, so often I grew up in a place where I was different and I was told I was different. And I just said, if I were just less objectionable, maybe nobody will notice. And so I kind of shrunk in myself. And so much of that was that. And then I realized, like, I can be more, and I can speak up, and I can actually open up. And it was a huge revelation. You know, I, like, for example, a few years ago, someone said, I think you should write a book. And I said, why? Like, I have nothing to say. And, you know, I just turned in my book on September 1st. I just completed writing, which is incredible.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I'm not a writer. And I kept telling myself, well, why would anyone want to read a book that I wrote? You know, but as I was going through this journey and I was writing it, I was thinking, well, even if no one else reads it, I did it. It's an accomplishment for myself. And, you know, I realized so often we tell ourselves all the reasons we can't, but what if we said we actually can? And even if it doesn't work out, we took a shot. You know, it's the, you miss 100% of the shots you didn't take. I live by that philosophy, which is if you take the shot, the worst can happen is they say no. No one publishes your book, you don't get the job, but at least you gave yourself the chance. And so that's how I really think about things, which is, you know, you're giving up the opportunity to even have a shot at something if you never believe that you can try it.
And I want to catch you on something that you just said a moment ago. I'm not sure if you got it. You said that I'm not a writer, but I just wrote a book.
But it's an identity.
You are a writer. Everyone writes.
Right?
Pen to paper, you type every day, you are a writer. And my coach said something to me, there's an audience for everybody.
I love that.
So why not me? Why not write something? Because someone will read it. There is an audience. So congratulations for that. Sabrina wants to know, how do you find your voice in the midst of many other voices telling you what you should do?
You know, this is so interesting. Like, women get a lot of feedback, but not about substance of their work, but about things like their style. You should speak up more. You're too aggressive. You know, you're not warm enough. You're not speaking up enough. You're speaking up too much. And I think that's a really difficult situation, right? And so you have to decide who you are, and then you allow the feedback to change you, but not too much. And so, you know, you have to say, what am I going to take out of this? Because all feedback has validity. But if you change yourself so much that you mold yourself into what someone else wants, that's not right either. And so, you know, you finding your voice and figuring out what do you care enough about to say, this is where I take my stand. These are the things I stand for. And these are the things I'm not willing to compromise. And these are the other things that I will take feedback on and I will change. I think these are all choices that we make. A lot of times we make them accidentally. And what I'm saying is make them intentionally. These are the things I'm going to stand my ground on. These are the things I'm going to speak about. These are the things I care about.
So tell us, what is the name of the book, when we can expect it, and how we can sign up to be on your waiting list?
Well, the one thing about book publishing is not like tech where you ship a product and it goes straight out. I submitted it on September 1st, and it'll probably come out in September of next year, which I'm very excited about. But the book is called Take Back Your Power, 10 New Rules for Women in the Workplace. And it's really about what I've learned. And it's the lessons not just I've learned, but I've learned from so many amazing women. So I interview tons of amazing women who tell their stories of how they've overcome different obstacles and how, look, the world is not fair. There's a lot of things that are never going to be fair. And it's just, that is the reality we live in. But there are times where we can take the power that we do have and we can amplify it, that we can help one another be successful. That, and so each of these rules are really about how we can make ourselves and other women more successful.
So I think, I know that Victoria's listening, the producer of this conference, and I know Adriana Gascoigne, the CEO, is listening. So we just found out the title of your presentation for the next Girls in Tech conference next September.
I will sign up. Sign me up. That would be incredible.
Thank you so much. Deb Liu, CEO of Ancestry. Congratulations to your book. We can't wait to see you again next year.
Thanks so much, Kim, and thanks for everyone for inviting me.